All right, so I just filmed a video that tried to go over positives of the year or positives that could happen for this year, and I spent at least 20 minutes trying to film it, and nothing positive was coming up because I was so hung up on last year, in which everything pretty much fell apart from the moment the spring semester started. Why did it fall apart? That's a great question. There are answers to that. And in my head, I feel as though it didn't need to fall apart as much as it did, but it seemingly did, because why the fuck wouldn't it? And it was a pretty not great video. I don't know if I want to upload it. I kind of want to upload it just for the raw intensity of the video and like the raw emotion of it, but I'm also not entirely sure if it would be beneficial. Because everyone always asks, not everyone always asks, but there's always that question of who does it serve or what's the point when you do something like that. And I would say that the entire point for me would be raw emotion, but the entire point for people watching would be what? What are they supposed to get out of that video? And I would probably just say the raw emotion of what I was thinking about, but I would also say that is that something they would need to see? And so that's just kind of the... I guess if the answer would be no, then there's no point in actually releasing it. So, I guess it will never be seen. But, I want to do a real video about what positives could be happening for this year. And I still, even after wanting to redo the video, kind of struggle with thinking about it because I get so hung up on last year. And I think I get hung up on last year because I'm still around those same people, in which I felt as though didn't help in trying to make the year better. And that's kind of an interesting point too, because I was talking to somebody earlier before, like at the end of July, how we talked about this thing called forgiveness. God, it feels so ewy and icky to talk about. But, like, forgiving whatever happened back then, forgiving the people who may have fucked you over or whatever, or who you've perceived will fuck you over, and oh god, it's so ugly and gross and so icky to talk about, because it's like, no, I'd rather not. Because at a certain point, that same edge and non-forgiveness is what got me to this point. Maybe? Actually, that's not entirely true. I have no fucking idea what got me to this point. But what I do know is I'm here now, and I have to figure out how to essentially get over it. And unfortunately, I don't think I ever will, at least not in this point in time, because I'm surrounded by those same people, and I can't be surrounded by those same people and get over it at the same time. That's kind of impossible. It's like telling a woman to forgive or get over whatever rape happened, even though she's in that same city, in that same area, and probably surrounded by that same ilk of people or whatever. So, it's like, I don't know. That's what I equated to. Maybe it's not equated to that, but that's what I equated to. It's a whole new school year. I think the school year, if I were to make some predictions, will be marred with a little bit more, maybe not a little bit more protests, less protests, but still protests because of what happened last year in Israel. And Israel? How do I say Israel? It doesn't matter. So the school has a high Jewish population, which I did know. And when the attacks happened, there was a high contingent of, I guess, pro-Palestinian. Actually, you see the. I filmed it earlier last year, so you can go watch those. But basically, an encampment happened in which lots of Jewish students were not very happy over, because they were like, yeah, it was just not a good sign, a good sight, or a good environment for any of the Jewish students. And it was also made a little bit more, not nefarious, but just strange, because a lot of the people doing the encampment didn't even go here. I would say like 90% of the people in the encampment didn't go here. So it was just like, what the fuck? It would have been made more sense if it were students, but like, it seemed as though there were people who did the encampment who didn't go here, and then students who went here who would talk on behalf of the encampment. So it was just like, I don't know. It was kind of weird. But ultimately, that is seemingly kind of for now over. So yeah. So there was that. In terms of my outlook on the semester for me personally, I would say it's going to be just another year. I really would like to be positive, but again, I'm in that same area with, around the same people. And it's just so difficult to actually look at those same people and be like, yeah, you're a positive person around, or a positive influence in my life, or whatever. Yeah, I don't know. I really don't know. Fuck. I don't know. It's just really difficult. But I guess the positives would be, I'm in a new internship and I'm doing something that's kind of adjacent to what I'd like to be doing in my life anyway, which is working, or either working directly with law people or working as a lawyer myself or whatever. Just essentially, I'm in a field that would be beneficial to me in terms of getting a real world view point about what it would be like to be someone working in either, because I guess my interest as well would be that. Anyway, I don't know, it would be interesting. So that's a weird positive. And then the other positive is I'll be graduating if I pass all my classes, which I should. I really wanted to go for like straight A's my entire time here, but seemingly last semester completely fucked that up. So now I'm just like, I'm just kind of in the, as much as I would like, I want to still get a really high GPA, which is also, I don't know. I'm still going to try. I guess I should not try just because of one little thing from last year, but we'll see. Anyway, I have nothing else to say. That's not true. Is it true? I don't know. I guess I just can't wait for it to be over and like leave. I feel a little bit bad not being able to like explore the city of Philadelphia as other people have been able to. It's been pretty limited only because I don't have a car, which is totally fine. I'm totally fine with using public transportation, as I think it works great. Other people don't think so, but I think it works fine. But just finding the time to do so, and finding the time to do something, and then finding the time to do something with someone else, because I really wouldn't want to do it alone, because it's like that's boring and dumb. So that's also just kind of, that's also something that's been, so maybe when I graduate I'll have time to do something in the city or something, but overall I'm just not entirely, I don't feel the need to do something in the city, especially after what happened earlier in July. Okay, there's going to be a commercial break, and then we're going to come back with something else. So, here it is. Okay, so. What was I going to talk about? Oh, so there was a, I don't know what video it was. There was a video I watched relating to people talking about being in relationships and whatnot, and it was a funny little interesting, oh god, I wish I knew what the video was, but it was a funny little interesting video, because I read the comment section of the video, because it was more interesting than the video itself. Well, the video itself had very great points. The comment section always brings a whole plethora of first-person perspectives that you will never get from anyone in real life, because everyone in real life seems to not know what the fuck they're talking about, or care to actually have a real conversation about those things. Or if they do have a real conversation about those things, what was talked about in the comment section is what I'm going to talk about now. So the comment section had a person talk about how this person was told by a plethora of people that they knew that the first step into getting in any sort of romantic sort of partnership is loving yourself first, or all this other shit. And the person pointed out that that's kind of a cop-out, because I feel as though a lot of the people in relationships, and this person also, in the comment section was like, A, I feel like those people don't even like each other, or like themselves. And then another thing is like, what makes you think that the person doesn't like themselves? Like, that's really dumb. To like just say that to somebody, like, oh, freaky, have to live, like, you don't, just say you don't know. And say you lucked into the one that you got into. Maybe that's not entirely true, but thinking about some of the people I know, it's just kind of like, I'm only thinking of one person who lucked into their relationship slash marriage, and then I'm thinking of other people where it's just like they're, I don't know, they're in it because, I don't know, time or something. But, anywho, this idea that you have to do all that sort of work or whatnot, and yeah, you do, kind of, I don't know. For me, it's very hard to justify those people's reasonings only because I see a lot of people in these sorts of, like, seemingly loser individuals are able to have loser relationships, or at least just relationships in general. Maybe they're not even loser relationships. Like, the idea that there are homeless people who have probably longer-lasting romantic relationships is very, probably disheartening for a lot of people, especially considering how the idea of being in one in the first or Western world is built upon you being successful in some way, whether emotionally or mainly monetarily. I guess this is only kind of relates to men. I don't know how it relates to women. If you're a woman, you can talk about this in your own little section of the internet, or you can just talk about it here. But from the perspective of, like, how they are built, it is seemingly, depending on who you ask, they are built through the notion that the person that you're picking is good for you and will provide you with some success in the future, or makes you better in some sort of way. As when they read the vows and they get wedding, it's like, you make me a better person. Like, yeah, that's great. It's such an interesting sort of, it's an interesting time in life when people are worried about, like, five major things. People my age and maybe a little bit older and probably a little bit younger, there are five major things. I'm probably going to name, like, three, but I feel like there are a lot more. So one of them is owning a home. The other one is finding a relationship. The third one is having money for things. And then, the fourth one I would say is having purpose in life. And the fifth one, what else are people bitching about these days? Having connection and community. I think those are the big five things that people are worried about these days. And it is interesting to just sit back and look at and hear people's perspectives on how they ended up in places or whatever. And it's just like, are you being serious, or are you just parroting what you've heard before? And I feel like that's what most people are doing. And you can't really ask people these questions about, like, oh my god, how did you do this? How did you do that? And expect an honest answer, because I think most answers are going to be copy-pastes from what they learned on the internet, or just some general life advice that probably isn't good. I'm going to give you general life advice that probably isn't good. And that's, life advice would be to try. And it's not just in terms of being in, trying to get something out of somebody about being in a relationship, but listen, trying in general. Try to do anything. I think there's this idea in the younger sphere of the American life of, like, being lonely is cool, and it's fun, and it's sad. I think people get addicted to the feeling of being sad. I don't really know if that makes sense, but they get addicted to the feeling of just, like, not being around anybody, and, like, they get addicted to the feeling of feeling bad for themselves. And that's great, and that's true, and that's sad, and you probably have an underlying issue, but I think a majority of people would benefit from just trying even a little bit. And I think a lot of people would benefit from being okay with being embarrassed, which I don't think a lot of people have ever been embarrassed, actually. I think you can I think there are things that are embarrassing, but I don't think people have been embarrassed. Maybe this is the same thing. I'm not entirely sure. But My point is, as someone who was embarrassed a lot as a child, whether that be through school, mainly through school, I have learned to just kind of do things when I want to do it and not really care what the consequences are or what other people think. While there are things where I'm like, oh my God, what is this person going to think? Well, I think those are more related to me noticing trends in the social zeitgeist of the interactions between men and women, and then having this stupid little man in your head talk about or be conscious of, oh my God, every little interaction you have with somebody who is the opposite sex of you, and that's just really retardedly annoying. But, so I despise the social zeitgeist for doing that. And as much as people might like to say that that is not, that you're doing that to yourself, I would also like to say people are products of their environment, and so the environment that they're part of, and the social conversation is all of these things about whatever sort of harassment or whatever, and then you can kind of expect the mental fortitude of someone such as myself or anybody who is male to be a little bit more cautious about how they interact with anybody. Anyway, that's a whole nother tangent. I was talking about something a little bit more important than that. Oh, fuck. Interacting, trying, doing things. I'll just start from doing things again. So doing things, you gotta do things, and try a little harder. Embarrassing, being embarrassed. So yeah, being embarrassed is like something that you're just gonna have to deal with. My camera's dying. Hold on. So, yeah, being embarrassed is something that you're just gonna have to like kinda learn to be okay with in like, at life. And I think one of the things is when you're embarrassed, it's kind of weird because it's like, especially as an adult, I can understand as a child or as a teenager, but like as an adult, no one really cares about you. that's kind of the thing that you should learn about. Like, no one gives a fuck about you at all. Like, at all. Like, it doesn't matter if you work with them or if you go to, even in like places like grad, like no one cares about you. You are useless to them. Unless you can provide something of monetary or social value, you are useless. They will never contact you. They will never call you. They will never do anything. They don't care about what you do. They will look your way when you do something that is out of the ordinary, but then they will look right back at their phones or whatever the fuck they were doing before and continue on with their lives. Think of life and people like the city of New York, because that's exactly what it is. You know who Rat Man is? The guy who like dresses up as a rat and carries a giant pizza through the subways of New York? That's what life is. People are not paying attention. They will look, they will go, what the fuck? And then they will move on. Because are you really going to dedicate your life to giving a fuck about that shit? No. So I think that's something that people have to take away from wanting to grow in life. Is just being embarrassed is a muscle you have to work out. Because sooner rather than later, you're going to be like, oh, wait, I don't care. I don't know. Anywho, God, what else did I want to talk about? I think that might be it. I think that's it. I think that the conversation around being in a relationship for these amount of people, being in a relationship is kind of like finding a job. It's really funny, now that I really think about it. People are always talking about, oh my God, how do these people find these people? And then if you really look at the conversation, you can mirror it to, oh my God, how do these people find these jobs? Oh fuck, you people can't drive. And it's like, well, you know, everyone has different circumstances and everyone finds someone at some point in their life, and some people find it earlier, some people find it later. And I don't know if there's a significant reason. I think some things you can obviously tell just by based off of how those two people who you're watching interact with each other or whatever, but also I think a lot of it just comes from, this is where I get to be a little bit, I don't know, more sociologically inclined, but I feel like really hot women and really hot men can't stand to be alone. And I've only really observed this in women because I'm not attracted to men. So I observed that really, really hot women can't stand to be alone. So they are always in something. Whether it be in a relationship or in a fling or whatever. And so I'm sure you can relate this to men as well. And I talked to someone else about this, and they talked about how because they probably get their value from being extremely hot, that they can't imagine not being in a relationship as an extremely hot person. I don't know if that makes sense. Yeah, that's funny. Oh, Jesus. Yeah, you people can't drive at all. Holy fuck. So, yeah, I don't know how true that is. And then I asked someone else a question about that stuff, actually. Who did I ask? Actually, I know who I asked. What was that woman's name? This person's name was what? I said... What did I say? Oh, fuck. I might have... What is it? No, that's not it. Oh, shit. Oh, maybe it's a lot earlier. Oh, okay. So what I asked is it ridiculous to assume that people who are really attractive to always be in a relationship? Because that was another thing that I started to kind of realize and notice, which is exactly what I literally just said about really hot people being in relationships all the time. And I don't think the person kind of really understood what I was saying. I don't think I explained it very well, but yeah, it's kind of a funny little thing I've noticed. And then I've talked to older people about this, and they say, like, they do, one of the things is they say those same people will find you later, whatever that means. Maybe not those same exact people that you're interested in now, but, like, people who are kind of like that, who were just, like, extremely hot, and then it all falls apart, like, 10 years later, because it was like, oh, well, this was dumb, why did this all fall apart, and all this other shit. And that's so super, it's so interesting considering how most humans live to like 80 years old, and this is the things that we do, these are the things that we do, and then some people don't live to 80 at all because they shoot each other, so they live to like 5, so, yeah, I don't know, yeah, it's an interesting little thing to think about, especially considering how I like to judge some people. I like to judge people who I think aren't growing. There's one person in particular who I feel like, well, there are a bunch of people like this, but there's one person in particular who I feel like could be so much more than what they are, but they just choose not to go anywhere. I have a feeling that if you live somewhere else in your life, not just in the same town you're born in, you will grow as a human being, and I think that's pretty much true for everything. Now, just because you were born in one town and you didn't leave doesn't mean you're not going to grow. But I think your chances of growing are very low. Anyway, I had this person in mind when I'm thinking about that. And then I realized, like, why would you want to do anything other? Because everything around you is so comfortable. And if the entire point of living life in America is just getting to a comfortable spot, if they were born into that comfortable spot, why should they have to leave that comfortable spot? Even if they're not growing, perceived to you to be not growing, it's still totally okay. So, yeah, I don't know. That's interesting. And this person is, like, conventionally attractive as a female, so it's, like, interesting. Yeah, I don't know. It's kind of funny. Yeah, I have nothing else to say. Anywho, that's all I got. I'm going to attempt to do another little small test. I really wanted to study today, but I really got distracted. I got distracted because of a term by Socrates called I Know Nothing. That term didn't distract me. I just realized after watching and then interacting with, even though I still could be very wrong, or I still could be very right, my initial viewpoint of the situation, after interacting with those people, I realized that I know nothing. And this is the same mentality I came into the program with. But that's a whole nother video. Essentially, that video would have been about the Michael Jackson dad effect and, like, how hard you have to be on your children to get them to be great, if that makes sense. And great to be, and great at, like, sports and stuff. That's fine. Do you need to, like, abuse a shadow? Or can you let them do it on their own? Or can you be kind of hard and not hard? Or can you just put them around competitive people and will they learn it that way? Or all that other stuff? I don't know. All right. Now that's all I got. All right. Bang.